In this presentation, I'm going to focus on communication in the online classroom. Many of the best teachers in face-to-face classrooms have outstanding communication skills. These skills, particularly written communications, are also essential for conveying subject matter information and assuring a well-run class when the class meets online. An instructor needs excellent communication skills to make the online classroom seem warm and friendly. Start early to set the right tone. We're going to look at several ideas to make the online classroom a friendly place. Instructors have several ways to make a good first impression before the course begins. One that I use every chance I get is to send a welcoming email. If you have access to student contact information, you can send a welcoming email to students several days before the class begins. If students must purchase books or if the students are distributed around the world, you will probably want to allow a longer lead time than you might for an in-house professional development course. The welcome email is a great opportunity to soothe some of the pre-course jitters your students may be feeling, especially if they have never taken an online class. You can let them know what to expect and provide login instructions so they can explore the online classroom before the course actually begins. You can let students know the course is open in your welcome email. If the course isn't ready, you can let them know when you estimate it will be ready. The welcome email is a good place to share your contact information and to remind students to take care of routine housekeeping matters such as updating operating system software, antivirus software, and media players. The General Information Instructor's Manual has a sample message to welcome course participants. Of course, you will probably want to modify it for your own use. A face-to-face classroom holds many visual cues for the new student to get settled. Often, the instructor in face-to-face classes has prominently displayed the course name and instructor name somewhere in the room. Students in face-to-face classes can usually tell at a glance whether or not they are in the right place at the right time, and whether or not there is a friendly face greeting them. The student knows if he or she is the first one in the classroom, which seats are still available, or whether or not a friend or acquaintance is in the class. If your class is fully online, or mostly online, it is important to provide some of these same visual clues to the student logging into your class for the first time. Generally speaking, students new to online learning, or new to the course management system, will need some extra instruction to orient them to the layout of the classroom so they can easily find things. Be sure to give enough information so your students know which documents and areas they should familiarize themselves with first. When possible, I prefer to make the course available to students a few days before the official start of class. Some of the students are eager to see what the course will be like. Giving them access to the course lets them satisfy their curiosity or allay their stress, whichever the case may be. It also gives you and the students the chance to work out any login difficulties that may crop up. Another way to make a good first impression is the appearance of your online classroom. This is a screenshot from the AST Foundations course, which is hosted in Moodle. Choosing what to post will depend on your unique situation, but consider including some or all of these things. A greeting. Directions on what students should do first. A pointer to the instructor bio. And a request for students to introduce themselves to each other. Those of you with web design experience have probably noticed there's a lot of information on the page. Usability experts who lack course management system experience might scold me for this design. Unfortunately, there's only so much one can do with course management systems. When I lay out an online classroom, I keep in mind that students want quick and easy access to the different sections of the course. In a very short time, they will be very experienced using the course website and comfortable with more complexity than a typical web user at a commercial site. This will lead to more links and options than I might otherwise choose to offer. I do try to be careful not to include too much information on the front page of the online classroom because it can easily look cluttered and overcrowded. Where possible, I include a pointer to more detailed documents somewhere else. I also try to include multiple access points to each section of the course so students can easily find what they need. Another aspect of creating a friendly classroom is to give students a safe space to seek help. Students have questions or misunderstandings about course materials or assignments. Sometimes things don't work as they should. Students need a place to ask for the help they need to succeed in the course, and they need to feel that it is okay to do so. I strongly recommend you provide that space for them in the course. It will save you a lot of time if you do. My preferred method is to set up a help discussion forum. Aside from personal matters that should not be discussed publicly, I require students to put their help requests in that discussion forum before I will answer the question. I tell them it is so their classmates will also get the benefit of their question and my response. While that's true, this practice also helps reduce the number of email messages I get asking the same question over and over. If and when I find out that multiple people had the same question, I go back to the source of confusion to see how I can modify it and eliminate the confusion. Fixing the problem will save me time the next time I teach the class or give the assignment. I have seen online courses where teachers have asked students to help out their classmates when they see requests for help, and I've seen teachers say students should not provide help for their classmates. Generally speaking, I have found it more beneficial to encourage students to help out where possible. Selfishly, this lightens my load, but it is often to the student's advantage as well. For example, sometimes a classmate will get to the answer before I can. It also helps the class and the students in the class be more independent. Occasionally, I will learn something I didn't know from the helper. Often, students don't know the best way to ask for help in an online environment. It's important to give them guidance on this. If there's a technical support number they can use, share that number along with the help desk hours. Post a message sharing tips about how to ask for help. Students want to know their teacher. In a face-to-face class, an instructor's personality and interests naturally come out during the class. Online instructors need to make a point to share some of this same information with students. In the lecture about the BBST course model, I presented a diagram of how the course components fit together and pointed out that some aspects of the course were purely social. The meet and greet forum primarily serves a social purpose, so in addition to putting your credentials out, you can also display some of your personality. The subject line for your introduction can be catchy or clever. It can also be serious. It doesn't have to be boring. Be yourself. Of course, your name and general location is informative. Online courses routinely have people from across the country or around the globe. Sharing locations helps everyone realize the geographic diversity of the group. That insight stands to help all concerned with the communication challenges that are inevitable with a distributed work group. Sharing a little about your work history and education may help establish your credibility or expertise as an instructor. In some settings, that's more important than others. Think about which aspects are relevant to the students you will have and share as appropriate. Sharing your hobbies and interests helps make instructors more personable to students. I've been surprised at the connection students form with me or each other based on a common interest. Finally, consider sharing a photo or video. It's important to some students to associate a face with their instructor's name. Regular communication lets students know the instructor is paying attention to the class and cares about their students' progress. This kind of communication is essential for those who teach others. In a face-to-face classroom, instructors often use a few minutes of class time to remind students about upcoming project deadlines, offer guidance and caution about the tasks for the coming week, provide feedback about class performance, or initiate discussions about current events that have relevance to the class. As I mentioned earlier, one of the preconceived notions students can have about online classes is that they are distant and impersonal. Time and again, online students have told me about classes where they never heard from their instructor. Even the graded assignments had remarkably little feedback. This is unacceptable for instructors who work in the BBST programs. We use regular communication with students for a variety of reasons. Certainly, forming a connection with our students is one important reason. A regular pattern of communication also helps to establish the rhythm of the class and establish the instructor's online presence to the students. Most of our students are professionals who are busy with work and family obligations. Providing regular reminders and feedback about the course helps them stay active and engaged in the class. Messages can also help connect the instructional tasks with the real world. In the BBST courses, we have a discussion forum specifically reserved for instructor announcements. Students consider the instructor's posts in that area to be required reading and essential to the successful completion of the course. With that policy in place, it's important for our instructors to limit their posts to things that are essential. We have other forums for non-essential information. For each instructional unit, we recommend two posts that we include in instructor announcements when we teach online. You can combine those posts, although they sometimes become quite long if you do. The first is a preview of the coming unit. This instructor posting gives class participants an overview of the coming week and highlights particularly interesting or difficult areas about the content they will encounter. If the workload is a bit heavier than usual, this post offers a good opportunity to warn students of that fact. Making this post also gives the instructor a chance to remind students how to correct persistent problems the instructor has noticed in previous weeks, or to tell students what aspects of their performance the instructor will be watching closely. An instructor can also share additional resources that may be particularly relevant to student efforts for the coming unit. The second post message that instructors should send regularly is unit feedback. The unit feedback post is exactly what it sounds like. In the post, the instructor can point out broad themes identified over the course of the past week, draw attention to individual contributions that are particularly insightful or noteworthy, or invite further participation in an especially engaging thread. An instructor should use this post to identify and correct any broadly held misunderstandings they've noticed, but never in a way that would embarrass individual students. To correct misunderstandings, you can ask students to review a particular chunk of course content, point them to additional resources, or create another resource for them. If at all possible, start and end this post on a positive note. Depending on the capabilities of the technology you are using, you might decide to email instructor announcements to students or to force them to subscribe to the posts in some other way. We do that for the BBST courses using Moodle's General Announcements Forum capability. Your students will soon figure out if you are actively participating in the course discussions or not. Critique, feedback, and encouragement will help engage students to become more involved. There are several ways you can participate in course discussions without dominating them. You can ask students to elaborate on their ideas or provide examples. Asking follow-up questions and inviting participation in particularly interesting or potentially interesting threads is a good way to get students involved. Help students remember to stay focused on responsiveness to their peers by including responsiveness as part of grading and feedback. It's tempting for instructors to become overly involved in a course or inappropriately involved in the discussions. Good questioning strategies can help with that. Nowhere is this more important than the Exam Cram forum. If we give students the answers, or if we ignore those discussions, or if we focus exclusively on formatting instead of substance, we squander our opportunity to make the experience meaningful for our students. When I first started teaching, these questioning techniques were difficult for me. I'm better now, but it's still not easy. This full-spectrum questioning for critical thinking chart can help instructors drag students out of the shallow and superficial conversations they sometimes inflict on us. You'll find a copy of it in your General Information Instructor's Manual. Here's how you can use the chart. If you're reading a student discussion and you're wondering to yourself, "So what? Who cares?" you can use the questions in the first column to probe further, perhaps digging to find out if the seemingly trivial response is part of something larger, or helping the students realize they need to think more substantively. The second column addresses matter of vocabulary and conceptual understandings. In the software testing field, we face multiple definitions for quite a few terms. Some of the questions in this column can help students realize that complexity. Others prompt students to make their meanings more clear. Reflect on discussions you've seen or heard in online classes. How can you imagine using these questions to target improvements to the student's performance or understanding? I'm not going to walk you through each column of this chart. You can find it in the Instructor's Manual General Information. I encourage you to use it every now and again as you read and respond to students in the discussion forum. The Facilitator's Palette is another tool to help you participate in class discussions. This chart is also in the Instructor's Manual General Information. It was abstracted from a book titled Facilitating Online Learning: Effective Strategies for Moderators. The authors of this book have identified a variety of different voices a facilitator can use. They refer to voices, but you might prefer to think of these voices as roles or personas you can take on as you interact with students. In the second column, they identify several different tones, and in the last column, a variety of critical thinking strategies to help respond to student discussions. The folks who developed this call it a palette, the thing an artist uses to mix perfect colors, a little dab from one color, a bigger dab from another color, until the artist has exactly the right color. You can also think of this as a menu, choosing one from each column. Although the voices, tones, and strategies can be used in many different combinations, the authors claim that most facilitators only use three or four at the most. They put this palette forward as a way to help online facilitators think about more combinations. Some of the combinations will reflect your natural style and will feel comfortable to you. Others will feel rather alien. Try out a few new combinations to see if you can expand your repertoire. Be warned, though, not all of the combinations work well together. For example, if you're trying to mediate a disagreement, you might want to avoid a few of those tones because you'll just end up making someone mad. Take a look at these descriptions. Can you imagine how they might work? Do you have any you can't imagine? You get to practice using these, along with the full spectrum questioning, in the next lab assignment.